Hi guys, welcome back to my channel, or if you're new here, welcome. So today I wanted to film my April wrap-up. In April, I participated in the Magical Owls Readathon, hosted by G over at Book Roast. I'll link her channel down below. If you're not familiar, Magical Readathon is a readathon that is based on the Harry Potter world, and this year was the third year. I don't think I'm gonna do a very good job explaining the readathon. It is pretty complex. In this readathon, you choose a magical career, and for each career, there is a list of subjects that you need to complete, and each subject corresponds to a certain prompt in the readathon. So the career I chose was graphic designer, which is a new career this year. And because I am actually studying to be a graphic designer, I thought it would match really well. And it was a pretty easy career to do. I didn't want to overwhelm myself with the amount of books I was gonna read. So for the graphic designer one, I only had to read 4 texts, but I actually ended up completing 10 prompts out of the total of 12. So overall, I'm very happy with the results of this readathon. I've completed a couple of very good books, and this is my best reading month and probably ever. I don't remember ever reading this much, and I'm very happy, and hopefully this will carry on into further months because I am very excited to pick up new genres and new books. So the first book I completed for the readathon is The Merciful Crow by Margaret Owen. And I gave this book 5 stars on Goodreads, but it's actually a 4.5 stars for me. I extremely enjoyed this book. The world was fantastical, and if you don't know, this book is about this magical world where the caste system is based on different birds, and for each type of bird there is a specific power that the people of this caste have. So as you could probably guess, the book is called The Merciful Crow because our main character is a crow, and she's part of the lowest caste in this kingdom, and they're basically the outcasts and the ones that are tasked with the dirtiest job, and that is to take care of the victims of this plague that has been present in the kingdom for as long as it's existed. And our main character, Fi, is actually a chieftain in the making, and she suddenly gets involved in a very complex political situation that puts her and the people that she travels with in a precarious position, and she suddenly has to take care of these very important fugitives. I'm not gonna say much more. It's a very interesting exploration of the caste system and injustice, but it also has such a great magic system and the atmosphere. When I first went into the book, I was absolutely confused. I didn't know what was happening. It was nothing like I've ever read before, and I really enjoyed it. And the more I learned about the magic system and the caste system, the more I was interested in it. Overall, I highly enjoyed it. I think it's a very interesting world, and the characters are very diverse and interesting, and there is actually an animal companion too, which I don't see in that many books. I actually left a review for this book on Goodreads, so if you want to check that out, I will leave a link to this down below. And I read that book for the herbology prompt. But yeah, it was a very good start to the month. The next prompt I completed for the readathon was Ancient Runes, and for that one I read Heartless by Marissa Meyer. I also listened to that book on audiobook, and I really enjoyed it. I thought it was a very nice retelling. It wasn't anything like I expected it to be. I absolutely loved the different tie-ins from the original Alice in Wonderland story, and just how everything was explained. Marissa Meyer did such a good job interpreting the world and explaining certain aspects of it that otherwise we wouldn't know what they meant. And of course, this is just an interpretation. It wasn't written by Lewis Carroll. This book, I think if you're a fan of Alice in Wonderland, I would highly recommend, because it explains so many concepts in such a nice and understandable way, but it still keeps this nice whimsical feeling to it, so it doesn't just put Alice in Wonderland into little boxes. It gives a nice backstory. I also really loved following our main character, Catherine, who is the future Queen of Hearts, and her progression from being this absolutely lovable, sweet baker with such wholesome, pure dreams and demeanor into this heartless, monstrous Queen of Hearts that has little regard for anyone's life. I am not going to lie, I think Marissa Meyer did such a good job making us root for Catherine as a Queen of Hearts, because by the end of the book, I hated everyone so much, and I wanted her to have the justice for everything that she suffered through, and I was absolutely behind her and her decisions. And from now on, I will never look at Queen of Hearts the same, because now I love her, and now I hate everyone else. If you want to discover how that could happen, how you can change your mind about Queen of Hearts, one of the most notorious villains, I would highly recommend checking out this book. Especially if you want to read Alice in Wonderland first and then pick that one up, I think it will make so many nice connections that will just click in your head. And I think that's the strongest aspect of the book. So next up, I picked up a book for Arithmancy that I wasn't planning initially to read for this marathon, but it was available on Libby and I did listen to this on audiobook. And that one is Stalking Jack the Ripper by Carrie Maniscalco. I love this book. I gave it 5 stars. I think this might be my favorite book that I read this month. Again, this is just a very interesting interpretation of history. So this story follows our main character, Audrey Rose, who is an apprentice to a forensic scientist. This is something that is frowned upon, but she's fascinated with forensic science and she wants to become a mortician. And the story starts when her uncle's business gets involved with police investigation regarding the murders of young women. So Audrey Rose, of course, gets very involved in the story, and her forensic science partner decide to hunt Jack the Ripper, but things take an unexpected turn. One of the criticisms that book received was that it wasn't really feminist, and people said how so many women in the story were just minor characters and they weren't interested or didn't hold important positions. They weren't trying to change their lives and be something beyond just a good wife, a good mother. I see where they're coming from, but I disagree, because I think considering the time that this story is set in, not many women had the opportunity to choose to do something, and Audrey Rose was going against the flow and she had to struggle through so many prejudices and hardships. I didn't think it was falsely feminist. I really liked Audrey Rose's comebacks against sexist comments that men constantly made. So overall, I really enjoyed reading Stalking Jack the Ripper, and it's the first book in a 4-book series. If you don't read much YA historical fiction, I think this one is a good one to start out with. It's not so heavy, it's still very entertaining, and the characters definitely have some modern worldviews that I appreciated seeing. So yeah, very enjoyable read, would highly recommend. So I think the next book that I read was for History of Magic, and that was The Wicked Deep by Cher Earnshaw. And that book follows a girl who lives in the town where each year, 3 weeks before the summer solstice, 3 sisters who were drowned 200 years ago possess 3 bodies of young girls in this town and go on a killing spree to kill young men. And this is a curse that has been recurring every single year from 3 weeks before summer solstice until the summer solstice. And the girls that possess the bodies are victims of witch hunts back in 1800s that were accused of witchcraft and drowned for it. So we follow 2 timelines. The first one is the one that's in our current time, and it follows our main character, Penny, who meets this newcomer in her town who inadvertently came to the town right before the killing is supposed to start. And he doesn't know what he got himself into, and she wants to protect him and takes him under her wing. And of course, things don't go as planned. I'm not gonna say much more about it. The second storyline follows the 3 sisters in the past and what led them to be drowned by this town and hated so much. I really enjoyed this book. I think I gave it a 3.5 stars. I think the atmosphere and the setting was great. I really felt like I was in a small coastal town or on an island, and I could almost smell the sea. And I think if you're like me and if you don't necessarily like stories set at sea, I think this one is very balanced and enjoyable to read. The reason I gave it 3.5 stars and not more is because I really wanted more of the backstory of the sisters. The snippets that we got were much too short for my liking. I really enjoyed the backstory in general more than I did the current story, but because it only was 5 or 10% of the overall text, I didn't enjoy it as much. I did guess some things that happened. So for the majority of the book, I already knew kind of what was happening. I still liked seeing how it all played out, and I was surprised at certain points, but by no means was I blown away. I would have really preferred if we saw more of the backstory, maybe how they haunted the town in the past 200 years and not just the year they were drowned and the current time. So this is not the fault of the book, it's just my personal preference. Overall, I think it's beautifully written, it's very atmospheric, and I think it has a nice, unique witch hunt plot that if you like that type of story, you would enjoy. I would still highly recommend this book. Oh, and just to mention, I read that book as an ebook through Libby. So next, I reread one of my favorites for Muggle studies, and that is Fangirl by Rainbow Rowell. I think this was my fifth read of the book, and as you can see, I do have a tab. These are just the parts that I liked. The story follows Kath, who is a fanfiction writer, and her journey as she starts college and is forced to go outside of her comfort zone and meet new people. This story deals with mental health topics and is very representative of different mental disorders. I personally really, really relate to Kath, the main character. I think I've reread this book every single year since I first read it. I absolutely enjoy the story. I love the fanfiction bits and I love the relationships between characters. And although I already know what happens, I still really enjoy rereading the story and getting back into it. And of course, I rated it 5 stars as always. If you struggle with anxiety and or you are starting college or are in college and university, I think this is something that you enjoy, but overall I recommend it to everyone. I just really love this book. It's my baby. So next, I read a short story for Potions, and that was The Strange Case of Dr. Jekyll and Mr. Hyde by Robert Louis Stevenson. I only read the short story and not all the other short stories because that was the requirement. And if you're not familiar with the story, it follows this mysterious man, Mr. Hyde, and his unlikely connection to Dr. Jekyll. I don't want to spoil anything if you're not familiar. This is a classic, so I think most people are familiar with what it's about. I have a bug that keeps buzzing by my window, so I'm just very distracted by that. So yeah, this was an interesting short story. I'm glad I read it because I've seen the references to it multiple times. I could guess what it was about. I don't know if I've been spoiled for what the story is about before or not, but I somehow subconsciously already knew. So I wasn't as intrigued. The writing was somewhat dense. I had somewhat of a hard time getting through it at first. It started getting easier by the end of the story, but I still felt like the way it was written was just not exactly for me. Overall, I enjoyed the story and I gave it, I think, 3.5 stars. I think it's very good basic knowledge to have about what the story is about. I'm glad I read it. It's a very quick read. It's only 69 pages, I think, and I hopefully will finish the entire collection of the short stories at some point, but it's not on top of my TBR currently. So next, I picked up the first volume of Lock and Key, Welcome to Lovecraft by Joe Hill. I am not big on comics. I generally don't enjoy reading comics. I've given them a couple of tries and every time I just come to the conclusion that they're not really for me. However, I did enjoy this story. I know that there is a Netflix show, but I do want to read the comics first. Despite the art style not being my favorite, I still found myself enjoying the story. I do want to continue reading them. I think I gave this a 4 star. It's an interesting story about a family who moves in an old mansion that has some magical keys that basically open doors to different types of worlds. It gives people the keys certain abilities. There's basically magic involved with the keys. So one of the kids discovers the key and yeah, the story goes from there. And I'm pretty sure in the future volumes we will see more of the different doors and the different keys. And I'm excited for that mainly. Overall, a very enjoyable read. And Lock and Key was for Potions. Next, for the prompt of astronomy, I picked up Grace Grimley's Frankenstein, assembled from the original text by Mary Shelley. This was a very beautiful interpretation. I really loved the steampunk art style mixed with the classical language of Mary Shelley. I really enjoyed how they complemented each other. And I realized I knew so little about The Story of Frankenstein. I've always been interested in reading it, but for some reason I never got to it. I never watched any of the movies or anything. The only movie that I've seen that had Frankenstein in it was Van Helsing. It wasn't even about Frankenstein, but it did feature him. Of course, I could see where things were going, which I think is a theme with a couple of the books this month, but I could already kind of see by the middle of the book where everything was going and what was going to happen, but I still really enjoyed it, and it was such a tragic, harrowing story. Let me just show you an example of the art style. It's very beautiful, steampunky, and it's kept throughout the book in the same color scheme, which was very nice. It felt very unified, and the text and the imagery complemented each other really well. I enjoyed this a lot, and actually, I think I gave this 4.5 stars. I think I gave it 5 stars on Goodreads. This is not one of my favorites just because I think the format is not for me, as I said with Lock and Key. Comics and graphic novels, despite me being an illustrator and actually being interested in illustrating a comic in the future potentially, I don't enjoy reading the format as much as I like the idea of it. I just like reading text and imagining things in my head, or seeing pictures and interpretations by themselves. Together, I feel like it's just overtelling for me, but this is my personal opinion. I honestly think this is a masterpiece. I think this is a really, really great interpretation. The text and the imagery complement each other so well that if you're even remotely interested in this, I would highly recommend picking it up, because me not being into graphic novels, I absolutely enjoyed this. So I think if you like them, that you will enjoy it even more. So yeah. So the next story that I listened to on audiobook is The Coldest Girl in Cold Town by Holly Black. You know, I just finished reading this book last night and I already can't remember the character's name. This is how bad I am with character names. I forget all of them. For the entirety of this video, I had to look up basically every single character's name. Even my favorites, I have to look up names too. I am so bad with character names. It's embarrassing. And I completed the story for Divination. And the story follows our main character, Tana, who wakes up in the morning after a party and finds out that everyone who was at the party is now dead and was killed by vampires. Except for her ex-boyfriend that she finds tied to a bed next to a hungry vampire that was chained to a wall next to him. And basically Tana has to decide what to do with them. I'm not gonna say much more because I think everything else will be a spoiler. The story was enjoyable, it was very interesting. I don't really read about vampires at all. I don't think I've picked up a paranormal book in ages. It was just the right amount of cringy, but it was also enjoyable. It wasn't what I expected it to be. I think it was very grounded and the setting felt very well fleshed out. I liked our main character and her companions and the interesting relationships they had, especially her relationship with her ex-boyfriend. This story also has a cast of very diverse characters, so that's nice to see. Overall, I really enjoyed this book. It's not one of my all-time favorites, but I really enjoyed it for what it was, and I wanted to see where it went. It wasn't super shocking, as most books on this list. I kind of saw where it was going, and I wasn't really shocked by the reveal. If you are looking for a good vampire story that is maybe just enough stereotypical but also enough unique, I would recommend this book. And the last book that I complete in April was One of Us is Lying by Karen M. McManus, and that one was for the Charms prompt. I really, really liked this book. I think it came out to be 4.5 stars for me. I didn't like it as much at the beginning as I did by the end, and one of the things that I absolutely enjoyed is the flipping the stereotypes on the characters. As you can see, even on the cover it says a geek, a jock, a criminal, a princess. The stereotypes of the characters were taken, and kind of throughout the stories we just see how people are more than their stereotypes. Some of the stereotypes, the way they were broken, was still kind of stereotypical, but others, particularly the story of Addie, I really enjoyed. I was really frustrated with her as a character at the beginning. I really hated the way she let her boyfriend manipulate her and how she was such a pushover and she had no respect for herself as a person. But as the story progressed and as we saw her character growth, I grew to absolutely love her. She was probably my favorite character by the end of the book. I just really loved seeing the character growth of all of our main characters, and I did have some guesses about the mystery. I think the way it resolved itself, I did consider as a possibility, but I was still trying to puzzle things out, so this one didn't disappoint. I really did like how everything got resolved, but specifically, I enjoyed this book just for the journey of the characters and for Addie's story. I really liked that one. I would recommend it just purely for that, but also for a good mystery. I don't think it's super mind-blowing, that's why it didn't get 5 stars for me, but I do think it's a very good character exploration and complex enough backstory and mystery that does keep you guessing. I wasn't really sure what happened until the end, so that was nice. I started reading this one physically and I read about halfway, and then I finished it on audiobook at 1.75 speed. I didn't know I was capable of that. I thought that my brain is just super slow and I have to read at the 1 time speed. Yeah, and definitely I like the ending of the story, the second half of the story, way more than I did the first part, so the book gets better. And I'm excited for the sequel. I want to see where the story takes our characters and what happens next. I definitely really loved seeing the relationships in the story and how they grew and the different familial settings that each of the characters have. It was just overall a very interesting exploration of characters that I enjoyed so much, so highly recommend. Okay, and the last two books that I just want to quickly mention are the second book to the Stalking Jack the Ripper series by Carrie Maniscalco, and that is Hunting Prince Dracula. That one I started listening to on audiobook, and I want to continue and finish it in May. And I also started rereading The Hunger Games by Suzanne Collins, and this is another one that I do want to complete in May. So yeah, these are all the books that I've read in April. I hope you enjoyed watching this video. Let me know down below if you've read any of these books or if you have any recommendations based on the books that I liked. I hope next month will be another good reading month. I am looking forward to it. I already have a couple of books queued up in my Libby app, so I'm looking forward to that. Thank you so much for watching, and I will see you in my next one. Bye! But this, but this, but this. Ugh.